lesson last week talks about love, amen. We had a nice discussion on the strength of faith working by love, which continuing on with the theme of faith. But as we found out last week, faith working by love, and if you don't have your love walk together, it would definitely affect your faith. Could affect your faith with salvation, but even after salvation, your faith walk could be definitely determined or hindered or enhanced by your walk of love. God is love, so therefore he doesn't do anything apart from love. So we have to always make sure that we are walking in love, displaying love, Not only just talking about it, also walking in love. So Hebrews 13:1 says, so let brotherly love continue. Hallelujah. We talked about don't forget to entertain strangers. Sometime or another, you probably have entertained an angel which you was not aware of. And above all things, above all gifts, the one gift that abide is the gift of love. That was Hebrews, 1 Corinthians 13:13. Now remains always faith, hope, charity. These three. Always faith, hope, and charity. These three. But the greatest of these is love. We always abide. Always want to have it. Now we're going to move to a topic today. Gets a lot of people in trouble. Their mouth. I mean, they say your mouth got you in trouble. If you've been quiet, you've got it. Whether you was right or wrong, your speaking brought this situation upon you. So we have to figure out how to. That when we do speak, if we do speak in wisdom, we speak in strength, and above all of our speaking is because of faith. Because, you know, whatever is not done in faith is sin. Is it sin? Whatever is not done in faith is sin. So you got to be walking in love, and you got to be walking in faith, and you got to be speaking because you have faith to speak. You believe. You establish with the Lord. You have faith to speak. And by doing that, that brings you authority. It gives you authority. So, we will see today our lesson, courage to speak boldly, with a sense of authority, if I was going to say anything of the name of that. Okay, so here we go. What happened here? Let's look at first at Mark 1:22, if we can in our Bibles. Here's something that we learned about Jesus. They were astonished at his doctrine. Mark 1:22, they were astonished at his doctrine. For he taught them as one that had, what, authority. And not as the scribes. In other words, when he spoke, his speaking brought attention. And he know what he's talking about. It's proven out. It's quite evident. It can't be disputed. You can argue all you want to. But what he has said has proven to be correct. Okay. And they were surprised at this guy's doctrine. And his ability to debate and prove his point. And then also, not only did he talk about his point, but he taught on his point. He had authority. He knew what he was talking about. Couldn't prove him wrong, not as the other folks that had holes in their positions. You could disprove them, kind of like the debate the other night. Luke 21:15. All right, he says here, For I give you, now this is when things get tight, you don't know what you're going to say, but you know you're standing in faith and you have to make a statement. And whether it is about the gospel or about whatever it is that you got to speak on, this is what the Holy Ghost will do. If you are a person of faith walking in love, at any given moment, this is what the scripture says the Holy Ghost would do. What does it say there in verse 15, somebody?
For I will give you a mouth and wisdom, which all your adversaries shall not be able to gainsay nor resist.
All right, all your adversaries shall not be able to gainsay means to prove you wrong, recorrect you, or correct you, or prove, debate you about it. They can't even debate you about it. So he says, the Holy Ghost, this is what the Holy Ghost would do. The Lord says, I will give you a mouth so I can talk, but also with that speaking wisdom, which all your enemies should not be able to prove you wrong or to debate against you, nor could they keep it from, they can't resist your proposal from coming to being. They can't do it because you have outsmarted, you have outwitted, you have used godly wisdom, and you're there in faith, and it's going to happen for you. Ooh, that's what the mouth. So I'm giving you mouth first, giving you a mouth, and I'm giving you wisdom. So some people have got a mouth but no wisdom. and no authority. No authority. They're just talking to be heard, and they have no authority. So speaking without authority, first of all, if you're showing up no faith and you got a mouth and you have no authority, nothing good is going to happen for you. Now, if you have faith, you have faith, and you have authority, and you have wisdom, you're speaking in any situation about anything, that authority kicks it in. Bam! That authority. I'm thinking about Matthew 28, maybe the last two verses of Matthew, the 28th chapter. So I'm going to try to see that. So Matthew 28 chapter. Maybe at the very end. Okay, maybe about like verse 16. Verse 18. This is what he says. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. So it's talking about all authority is given to me. And then verse 19, what he did was he turned right around and gave it to us. Go ye therefore, and basically you can say, in authority, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father. Here's the authority for you to baptize. I give you the authority. And in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Verse 20, I give you the authority to teach. You have the authority to teach. Teaching them to observe all things. I'm with you, even to the end of the world. So speaking is with when you have the authority to say it. I have the authority to say, I'm healed in the name of Jesus. I have that authority. The devil's showing up. I'm going to give you a cold or sickness or what have you. And I say, no, I have the authority to say it. I'm healed right now. I'm healed on this earth. I have the authority to call my shots. So, faith, mouth, and authority. Faith, mouth, and authority gives you boldness. You got to know you got them. I got faith. I got a mouth. I'm going to be talking. And I got authority to say what I say. And it equals, it comes out bold. And it gives me what I want. Romans 10, you get your first authority. Romans 10, 9 and 10. That's when you first experience your authority. I'm out of here, Satan. Bye. I confess Jesus as Lord and Savior. I believe it in my heart. I say it with my mouth. That's my mouth. And the Bible says confession brings you salvation. So out of here, Satan, bye. You can't hold me no longer. I'm loose. I'm free. So that's when you first experience your authority. A lot of folks don't realize it. You just I'm free. Ooh, wait, that burden of sin is gone. What happened? Ooh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And then they don't know that for the rest of your life, you got to run with this authority. You got to run with this mouth. You got to run with this faith. Okay, praise God. Now, dealing with people. This is what happens when you get full of the Holy Ghost and when you have the experience that Stephen had. Stephen has this. He has faith, and because of faith, he has a calm boldness. Remember we talked last week with that great peace, how they that and nothing shall offend them. So when you are living in faith, you have this ability to be bold, but you're also calm. Mm-hmm. You're throwing around authority, but you're also calm, cool and collected. You don't have to get upset and fight everybody, fuss everybody out to prove your point. You just say what you got to say when the Lord fills your mouth with what you got to say, and it comes out with authority. It's like a mother at home sitting down and said, "Boy, go wash the dishes." And she don't have to, "Boy, somebody get up and wash them." She just say, "Go wash the dishes." Other day, "Go cut the grass." Yeah, he don't have to throw a tantrum. He just say it because he just threw his authority out there, and it's going to be done. You know, there ain't going to be a whole lot of, like, "Wait a minute, let me prove it. Let me debate this." I remember my dad telling me, go in there and wash the dishes on a Sunday. Go wash the dishes. Get them done. Get that done before 10 o'clock. I'll be right in the middle of my TV program. It's like 9:20, 9:30. You know it's coming. It's going to end at 10, and I'll go wash the dishes. Now? Go get the dishes cleaned. You're going to bed at 10. Well, yeah, but the movie's on. They're going to go on. It's authority. So he didn't have to, get a court order or anything like that. Just sit. Okay, so that's what faith gives you. A calm boldness. Now, let's look at the phenomenal success that this type of living would do for you. Ooh, phenomenal success. Phenomenal success, and we're fortunate to see it as an organizational success today. I think that's going to be, look at Acts 4 and 4 if we can. So we start at verse 1 in Acts 4 and finish up to verse 1 of chapter 4 and finish up with verse 4.
And as they spake unto the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came unto them, being grieved, they that taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead, and they laid hands on them and put them in hold upon the next day, for it was now eventide. Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of men was about 5,000.
Amen. So the early phenomenal success of the church going forth, as Jesus had told them to do in Matthew 28:16 chapter, was that they went forth boldly and with their mouths. And proclaim the resurrection of the dead organizationally. And the result was phenomenal success with being with faith, calm, and bold. Gave them phenomenal success in bringing in a lot of people. Peter stood up in Acts 3. Faith, confidence, authority brought about boldness, and his first message said, about 3,000 people gave their lives to Jesus Christ. Ooh. And then they keep doing it. Thousands of people, it seems at a time, are coming into the kingdom of God, coming into the church. Now, I believe in massive success. I believe in massive outreach. I believe in massive results. because of the activity of the church bringing in the masses. These 3,000, these 5,000, all they knew was that I believe that message, I believe what I heard, and the main question was, what should we do? What must I do to be what? Saved. And they gave the answer boldly, and masses, people, can you imagine just a whole bunch of people just coming in and making up a church? And now with them, when you bring in the masses, you also bring in mass problems. Mass personalities. Opinions. Everything. Everybody from different neighborhoods, communities, and all like that. And you're going to have, what, cliques and stuff. And mess. And bring in the masses. But the example that we have is to bring in the masses.
Then teacher.
That being said. Brought in the masses. Let's see what kind of problems you bring in when you bring in the masses. Go to the sixth chapter. See if I can get my dear Lord. Verse 1. And in those days, like they brought in the masses, and in those days when the number of disciples were what? Multiplied. Yeah. There arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews. Because they're fussing already. Because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called a multitude of disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. So, 6 and 1, you have a big problem. Now, when you're full of faith, you got faith, you have the authority, you have the wisdom, you got the masses that came in, you got the problems, but also you have the solution to the problems that come in. Yes. Well, we're just preaching. We just preach. We just want to have church and worship and so forth. Now, you have the ability, the power and authority to bring in the crowd, but you also have the wherewithal for the solutions for the problems that come in. Mm-hmm. How do we know that? Because we just read earlier where he says, I will put in your mouth. I will give you the what you need for the situation that arises. So you don't have a solution before they get here, but you know they're going to bring a problem, and the Lord will give you the solutions to the problems when you get them. Boom. Your job, all job, just to do what go you there for, and do this preaching boldly and in faith. Confidently and with authority, and cause them to come in, and they come in. Now they come in with all these problems. Now what God says, I want to give you, I give you the solutions as the problems arise. So what was the solution? Starting from verse 2 to verse 4 of Acts 6 of this particular problem. Someone help me out. 2 through 4.
Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you, 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word.
Of the word. So the only time they got that solution was when the problem came about. They didn't have any predetermined solutions sitting on the shelf and waiting for stuff to happen. It's just simply it happened. The Lord gave them the wisdom and the mouth and the authority to say what to do. Hallelujah. Okay. Well, hallelujah. All right. Now, what else Williams got to talk about here? Gift of faith. All right. The gift of faith. We're going to see how that works here in just a little bit. Let's look at Stephen. And let's look first in the book of Acts, the 6th chapter. And we did read verse 3, so we're going to go to 6 and 8. He's really jumping, got me jumping around a little bit here. Let's look at 6 and 8 and see what happened. Someone read that, please.
And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people.
Well, is that our first introduction to this guy named Stephen? In the book of Acts, right? Yeah. Was Stephen an apostle?
No. It just says he was full of faith in the Holy Ghost.
Where'd he come from? You know, he's not with the 12. He didn't come with them. Who was he?
All it says about him is he was a man full of faith and the Holy Ghost.
So, this guy named Stephen, and here's where it gets really interesting. This guy named Stephen, he's not part of the original group. He comes from a different culture, community, different part of town than the original 12 and those that started the church. He didn't hang out. They both started believing the same message, but Stephen says, that's not my crowd. Peter, and who else? Matthew, John. Those are not my homies. That's why I put it. They're not my homies. We didn't go to school together, come up and say hey. I had to get introduced to them. But the Stephen, he gets full with the same Holy Ghost, he has the same faith, the same belief that they have. But we got different backgrounds. Different parts of the hood. So let's see what happens here because of that. Praise God. All right, I'm trying to keep this deal going here, okay? And so Stephen, let's tell you a little bit about him if I can already. Stephen had the gift of faith with wisdom. But he came from not the Jewish culture out of Jerusalem, but he came from a Greek culture. A Jew living in a Greek culture. Greeks being considered Gentiles. Greek community. And the people that caused the issue in verse 9, someone read that if you will, verse 9 of Acts chapter 6.
Then there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of the Libertines, and Cyrenians, and Alexandrians, and of them of Cilicia, and of Asia, disputing with Stephen.
And if you're just a novice Bible reader, you just read right over the Liberines, Cyrenians, Alexandrians, of Cilicia. Let it go. They said it, just let it go. But they had an argument with Stephen. Why are they fussing with Stephen? And he identified who he had a problem with. Uh-oh, let's see here. Williams had a problem some years ago with some of them folks. It's skirts only, down to the heels, sleeves all the way out. Let me keep going. I get in trouble in a minute. Yeah, let's see. So, yeah. No shorts, no swimming, no sports, no nothing like that. Go home, go to church, get up, go home and go to church. Williams didn't come from that. I come from the streets. Same neighborhood Stephen come from. So, all right. How am I going to deal with these folks? How many ever had problems with Jesus-only people?
Jesus,
I wonder if Timothy's open today. Check it out. Jesus, nobody ever had no issues with them. You gotta be full of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, you gotta speak in tongues to be saved. if you're not full of the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues, you're not saved. Nobody had no issues with none of that. So I come from a different culture, you know. I come from some Baptist people that was saved to the bone. Saved. And then when I used to hear that, if you don't speak in tongues, you're not saved, I'm going, oh, man. And if girls play sports, they're not saved. They're not ladylike. So me and Stephen, we come from somewhere else. You know what I'm saying? Now here's Stephen's issue was that he was like, Peter and them come from the fact that, see, remember, Peter got in trouble because he started acting like the Gentiles. Sitting down eating with him and so forth. But pretty much he come from a strict Jewish background. He says you don't do nothing like that. You eat the kosher stuff and you keep it straight. So when Peter, and they found out Peter was over here living on, visiting with other people over in the Gentile, Peter got scared. Because I come from a crowd that don't do that. All right, now, let's see here. So what was Stephen up against? He was up against, this is the way Moses did it. This is the way, and you saw a word synagogue, I believe, in there somewhere. Verse 9. Then there arose certain other synagogue. Today's term, we're going to say, because we're over here in Gentile world, we're going to call it what? Church. The church of the happening now in the corner, greater, greater grace. Greater, greater free. Greater, greater Baptist. First great Baptist church of the whole city, or everywhere and everywhere. So he got the problem with what kind of folks? The church people. Yeah. Church folks giving him up time. So disputing, who are they fussing with? Not the unbelievers, but they fussing with who? With Stephen, fussing with him. So the Lord had to give him a mouth of what? Wisdom and courage of what to say at the time that the what? Problem comes up. Not only does the problem come up, but so does the what? Solution.
Pastor William, yes. That great problem then had to be just as today when we say, in the name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And then you would see Stephen saying, doing these miracles and, wonders, and he had to be saying, in the name of Jesus.
Well, he said in the name of Jesus. When
thinking.
Yeah, there's a church doctrine that in Jesus only. Jesus only. Anybody never heard of that?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Jesus only. That's a church doctrine. There is ain't no way nothing else happening. Jesus only. That's, we just straight, that's the way. Now, but the thing about this guy Stephen is that he wasn't no fluke. He wasn't no slouch. Mm-hmm. When he prayed, stuff happened.
Yeah. But he always said in the name of
Jesus. Oh yeah, he was in the authority of Jesus. That was no problem. Yeah. But he had a problem with this Jerusalem crowd, this Moses church folk, that said, we gotta worship like this. Mm-hmm. And Moses said, so Stephen is saying, where I come from over here in this Gentile neighborhood, they didn't have no kind of church like what Moses was at.
And it also mentions them in the synagogue of the Libertines. Mm-hmm. And the Libertines were freed slaves. So they probably still had slave mentality, too.
Sure. They were free people, freed slaves from the Roman Empire. So they had an attitude anyway. Well, I don't know, good or bad, but they had an attitude that didn't match the attitude of a person who's walking around in authority and knew who he was and wisdom. And they said, well, so, you know, we got to have church this way. Not all that fast music, but some of them hymn books where you just read. And the spirit is down. And nobody's jumping, clapping, moving, dancing, and like that. Anybody ever been in the spirit? People say, I can't go to a church where they're up and dancing and running and shouting. And I just can't go to that church. I got to go to somewhere where it's quiet. You can hear the mouse in the corner. So it's all, when you bring in the masses, you bring in all the what? Problems too. You got to go win them. And he says, don't win them ones and twosies. Wins them masses. Demonstrate it. Demonstrate it in the book. Bring them in by the droves.
You don't get them to the altar and tell them they got to start taking stuff
out. You just bring them in by the droves.
Some say take them, others
do something to make them come see what's going on over there. So they come in by the droves, and you got everybody from everywhere, and everybody's problems is coming in too. That's for sure. You bring in the masses, you bring in a whole bunch of problems. But as you bring in the problems, you bring, the Lord says, I'll give you at the right time the what? Solution.
And wisdom.
At that time that you need the answer to those problems, I'll give them to you. Acts 6 and 1. Got a problem? Acts 1. Got a solution? Acts 2 through 4. Mm-hmm. Somebody, I thought it was going to
Did you ever
think?
No,
okay.
I was thinking.
Okay.
But no, let me just say this.
Okay.
My thought has been in studying this and just reflecting over the different denominations and all. And this may sound silly, but you know, you sometimes wonder, is God going to have all these different compartments in heaven? You know, it's going to be like if you can't. It just, you know, wonder, my mind wonders sometimes, you know, what it's going to be like there. And I don't think so, you know.
I don't think so. All that's going to be done. Because he says all race, people, colors, creeds, everybody. Here we go. So, but down here on the earth, man being man, this is where we do it over here on this side. So this is the way you get it done. And you got a whole bunch of folks saying, no, I never heard nothing like that. What are you talking about? We said, no, you have just like you had back in Moses' day. So here's the deal. The phenomenal success of the church, it gets a lot of favorability with the people. Let's look at Acts 2:37. Okay, someone read it, please. We're bringing them in.
2:37.
Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do?
Yeah, and Peter gave the answer. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't think Stephen's in this crowd. When they asked the question, the unsaved people asked the question, they asked the question to the first church organizers. Peter being the leader of it, Peter gave them the answer. But Stephen was not one of the original church leaders. Look at 4:21, Acts 4:21. Someone read that if you could, please.
So when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding nothing how they might punish them because of the people. For all men glorified God for that which was done.
Yeah, is that right? Okay. All right. And then Acts 5:13.
And of the rest durst no man. Is that it? That's what you want?
Okay. Yeah.
And of the rest durst no man join himself to them, but the people magnified them.
Yeah, so they have favorability with the people are liking them, growing. And then, now we want to get into the lesson today. And then, and Stephen, he was a guy from another neighborhood, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. And why did he, and why was he able to do that? Simply because Stephen bought into the belief of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That's what Stephen did. He bought in, he fully bought into Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. So that gave him, he wound up with full of faith and power, and he had gifts working for him. He was not of the original church folks, and great wonders and miracles among the people. And it brought him a high level of popularity. You can't overlook that. The guy's getting results. He's got a lot of folks following him. He's not on the hierarchy of the church leadership, but the guy's getting results. So he's getting what? Popular. Okay, you can't say you can't argue with what?
Success.
Alright. Verse 9, we see that they're all getting mad at Stephen because he's just a free agent believing and getting stuff done. But he's not separated from the church. He is a part of it, but he's not in the hierarchy yet. Verse 10. And they were not able to resist what?
Wisdom.
The wisdom and the spirit by which he operated. Didn't they, someone read verse 11 if you will, please. I'll get back to that.
Then they suborned men who said, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God.
Yes, so here it says that they could not debate, they could not prove any of his points wrong. You got to have a choice like Moses did. He would say, no, you just got to believe in the Lord. You don't have to wear a skirt all the way down to the ground below your heels and sleeves as long and no makeup and earrings and all like that. You just got to come to church and believe. Even if you were, he says, I ain't got nothing to do with anything. They say, oh, yes, it do. I mean, no one been to a church like that. And I have time to, for folks who got them kind of problems. Can't wear pants. Girls got to be in them dresses and all that. Well, I mean, it's, you just got to come to church and have church. But Peter would make his point, and they could not dispute his point. It was so strong. So what they did was they brought up some liars. He said, we got to get this mess straightened out. So we got to go before the big dogs. In church court. Remember last week we say, before you go to the civil authorities, take it to the who?
Church
leaders. So we're going to put Pastor Hill and Sister Hill behind the table. We're going to bring the one that says you can't wear pants and the one that says you can wear pants. The one that says you can't wear lipstick and you can't wear earrings. Pastors, y'all sit there. Y'all need to settle this out. Sister Hill, I know y'all ain't had no phone calls, conversations, like nothing like that happening between saints.
Years ago. Not recently.
But years ago. Right. It was a good one. But somebody got saved when they brought in their
And you know, let me just say this. Shoes with no heels and no toes. Somebody came to my house once and told me about it.
Is that
right? I never heard of that. Honestly, I never heard of it. And I mean, she dressed me up and down about that.
But yeah, somebody met me on the church parking lot with a tape measure measuring my sleeve.
Okay, bro.
Well, I was just thinking about how new this was to right after Jesus being crucified, and how these people were hearing stuff that to some of these Jews were way out there, because their thought was that we just got rid of your leader, and now you're kind of with this Jesus Christ stuff still. You know, you saw what happened to him.
There were pockets of dispute all over the place. Moses, like Moses did it. Paul crucifying the church. See, Paul's not part of the crowd nowhere yet, other than the fact that he's going around killing folk. I think Pastor Hill wrote that out, addressed that Wednesday night.
Right.
He's going around killing, throwing people in jail. That's what Paul is doing. Stephen's just a guy from another community. He hears about Jesus coming to full faith in him. He gets the gift, God's grace gives him the gift of faith and all kinds of stuff. He's getting results. He's not part of the big hierarchy of the church. He's not against anything. Just that those are not my homies. You know, I don't hang out with Peter and John and Matthew. I don't really know them. But as he gets to start visiting, they get to know one another. You know?
People that he's talking to here, though, are just Orthodox Jews.
Yeah, they're just straight up Jews that have been in slavery, and they said that they couldn't worship like they wanted to under slavery, but they know their history, and all we know is what Moses did. So we're going to do it the way Moses had church. We ain't doing all this other stuff that you're talking about, and grace. You know, no, it's free and all that. No. We got to have church like this. Where's that golden censer? Where's the table of showbread? Who's sprinkling the mercy seat? Instead, you got that organist up there on the, like Keith used to be, dancing all over the place. What is he doing? Why don't he sit down? The whole choir's up there dancing. What? I can't have church, and we had folks leave because of that. And we had them leave because of that. We had them join because of that. We had it going in, but just,
what's wrong with folks?
Because everybody was bringing in their, what, their different stuff from wherever they came from.
Oh, Lord.
I knew I was going to get in trouble. All right.
The answers come to message.
That's right.
Verse 12. What'd they do? Verse 12.
And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes and came upon him and caught him and brought him to the council.
All right. So here you go. Now you're in trouble, Stephen. Now you're in trouble. See, he had a different, broader view of everything than those that were closed-minded. All right. So, Mark 6 and 2.
You know, except a lot that they even sit in there and listen to him.
Yeah.
Most of these people get up more
quiet. Well, yeah. Okay, then. Just to see how this kind of matched what Jesus had. Did he have kind of the same problems? Mark 6 and 2. What happened there? It's a, something on the first he said unto them, why do ye...
Mark 6 and 2.
Oh, I'm in 6 2. Luke 6.
Mark 6.
I'm sorry, Mark 6 and 2. Right? It's kind of on the same subject, though. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many hearing him were what?
Astonished.
Saying, from whence had this man these things? And what? With wisdom. Is this which is given unto him? That even such mighty works are worked by his hands. So when you're walking in faith, you got a mouth, and you believe what you said, great things will happen. Ooh, that was worth a quarter. When you got a mouth, and you're walking in faith, and you say what you believe in your heart with that mouth and walking in faith, great things will happen. He began to teach in the synagogue, and many heard him and were surprised, how has this man these things? What? Wisdom and mighty works because of him. With the quarter. Is not this who? It's just a regular old man. Who is this? And it says at the end of verse 3, they were offended at him. Hello. Guy talking smack. Backing it up.
According to the word, we know they didn't love the
lie.
Backing it up.
Mm. They can't dispute it. Can't debate it like you could a couple of those candidates on the stage the other night.
Oh, don't bring that up.
So it's getting pretty bad. While we're here in the New Testament, let's go to St. John 7:27. All right. So, why are we here? I do not know.
Why
are
we at
27:10? Yeah, I'm in St. John.
You know,
someone read that, if you would, please.
Oh, howbeit we know this man whence he is, but when Christ cometh, no man knoweth whence he is. Yeah. Is that the one you want?
This with Stephen, you know, is a matter of parable. Who is this guy come out of nowhere?
Yeah.
Maybe was it 26?
No, this is what I want. I just can't get my fat fingers to work. Okay. Okay, now we got it.
This man is no toy.
How bad? You know this man, this he is. But when Christ come, no man know, no man. So they don't say, we don't know if this guy is full of stuff or if he's really got the real goods. He might have some tricks. We don't know if this is the real Messiah. They're speaking about Jesus. We don't know if this is the real one or not. And Jesus is saying, I am he. He said, no, the real Messiah is on his way. We don't know nothing. Who are you? You're just a carpenter's son. How are you getting all this stuff done? What's up your sleeve? So they didn't want to accept Jesus as Messiah then. And here's Stephen, years on down the line, doing the same thing. Getting stuck in, who is he? Where's he from? He's from that Greek neighborhood over there. That's what John's and Matthew's crowd was saying. She's from that neighborhood over there with them Greeks. And the Greeks are saying, who is this Steve? Who is this? He just lived right here. What happened to him? He got saved. He's still believing. And mighty works are coming out of him. So everybody's mad at him. They can't believe. What is this? So now they're going to say, we're taking you to the elders. Mm-hmm. They're going to settle this. Even though you got great works and you're doing great stuff, we just got some reservations about you.
Same way they felt about Jesus.
Same way they felt about Jesus. That's why we're here in 727, is that he does stuff, but this ain't the Messiah. Who is he? This is a carpenter's kid.
Verse 25 of the same says, then said some of them of Jerusalem, is this not he whom ye seek to kill? For lo, he speaketh boldly, and they say nothing unto him. Do the rulers know indeed that this is the very Christ? Howbeit we know this man, whence he is.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, verse 13 of our lesson, Acts 6:13. And set up false witnesses, which said, this man ceased not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and the law. Well, verse 14. For we have heard him say, true or false, what they're saying here. We have heard him say, where did he get Stephen get that whenever they accuse him of sin? He's following his mentor, Jesus. Because whenever they accuse Stephen of sin, Stephen is saying the same thing that Jesus said. So where is that pointed out? Matthew 26:61. If you look there, you see. Here it is. If you're there, I'll read it. And said, this fellow said, I'm able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days. And Stephen said something along the same lines. And the high priest arose and said unto him, answer thou nothing. What is it which these witnesses against thee? In verse 63, Jesus held his peace. The high priest answered and said unto him, I adjure thee by the living God that thou tell us whether thou be Christ, the Son of God. Now, can anybody remember who the judge is asking Jesus this question? When Jesus went before the Sanhedrin, what was the name of that judge? What was that? Caiaphas is the judge. And guess who is the same judge that's asking that they brought Stephen to? Same guy. So this judge is saying, I've heard this before. I've seen this movie before. Now we got another one. Is this another one? So you got to see how close our message, our work has to match the master's work. Because when they bring you up, you got to be up on the same charges. If you up on just overthrowing the government, overthrowing the city, You're up on the wrong charges. But if you're up on the same charges that Jesus was brought up on, you got some pretty good ground to stand on. And that's what happened to Stephen. He said he got the same charges. And now this judge has said, I've heard this before. Who is this? Okay. All right, so we'll go back to our lesson here. Verse 14, we've heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth should destroy this place, should change the customs which Moses delivered unto us. And all that sat in the council, looking steadfastly on him, saw his face as it had been the face of a what? Of an angel. So if you look at Acts 7, guys, Acts 7 and 1, the same high priest was over the trial of Jesus. And they then said to the high priest, are these things so? And the answer that Stephen is going to give is amazing. Because when you're caught up in a dispute, in your argumentative, you have to be, we said you got to be calm and you got to be bold. But you got to be right. And this is how you prove your point. Say the elders didn't. I was right. And the elders was wrong. How should I address the elders?
Got the word.
Oh, the judge. How should I address the judge? You go into a courtroom. Look, guy. I mean, you know you're 100% right. You got the goods. You got all the evidence. How should you address the judge? The officers of the court. They say, when we come in, should you stand up? When the judge come in, he just walks through the door and everybody what? Stand up. And they stay standing up till he what? Sit down. He's a crooked judge. We already know that. He's dirty. but since he's dirty, I'm just going to stay sitting down. I don't respect it. Oh, I show up dressed in my shorts and t-shirts and flip-flops in court. I know I'm right. Got all the goods on my side, evidence on my side. So how you show up? No. You come in with what? Respect. You come in with respect. And this is what Stephen did. He said, men, brethren, and what? Fathers. He says, listen. Now what he's saying is that I'm one of y'all. I'm a Jew too. I grew up in that Gentile neighborhood over there, but I'm just as Jewish as anybody in here. I'm a Jew. I'm a Jew. Because I'm calling you my what? Brethren and fathers. We in the same family. Listen up. And you know what he's saying is that I won't do anything to what? Hurt you. That's what he's saying. I love all of y'all. I ain't going to do nothing. I disagree, but you know I ain't going to do nothing to what? I ain't going to tell you nothing that's going to what? Hurt you. So that's the first thing, he smoothed the waters. I ain't going to tell you nothing that's going to hurt you. He says, the God of who? Appeared unto our father who?
Abraham.
Why didn't he start with, they've been fussing with Moses about me and Moses. So why didn't he say, take it straight to the Moses doctrine?
That's
why
you're
at the beginning. He went straight to the beginning. And says, Abraham. And he says, now, wait a minute, Abraham. How many laws was given to Abraham? How much of this stuff y'all fussing about was given to Abraham? None. What made Abraham a friend of God? Faith. Boom. So he's killing all of their arguments. So the thing about our father Abraham is that he was a friend of God through what? Faith. And that's what he's trying to get over to them. And somehow or another, when we get into our disputes with people, we have to bring it all the way back to the promise of what? Everlasting life. God saved what? Everybody. Sister got on some earrings, God saved her. You say, there'll be some people who was back in the day. I don't know if you could have stayed all day. I was telling you like it is. You might have been out of here by 10:30. And then it caused you some problems. All kinds of ways. So, a brother over here out of town. Oh, two of them, three of them. Oh. By 10:30, y'all be gone. So, it's all about the promise. Taking it back. Before we even got into Canaan land. Before we crossed over. Our stuff started way back in Mesopotamia. God and Abraham. That's when our life started. When God called Abraham. So he says, so let's take it all the way back. And all the stuff that's been picked up since then, it's just in the way. In the way. He says, I'm operating by faith like Abraham. That's why I'm doing all these miracles and getting all this stuff. Because I'm operating by faith. I'm not tied down by nothing but by faith. I come from over here. The Jerusalem church come from over there in Jerusalem. Matthew, John, I love you and all y'all, but you know, I ain't come from where y'all come from. And that's how I used to be kind of around here, is that I didn't come from church. I mean, I attended a time or two back in the day, but I didn't have a life where you, I just couldn't, I used to, I knew it was a girl who used to go to my school. She wore black all the time, down to her, all the time. And she stood out. She was pretty, but she was just covered up black all the time, every day. Wow. You know, I just that seemed like bondage to me. What is this? You know, back in the 70s, you were stylish. Broad collars, platform shoes. Yeah, remember that? I had a fish in there, you could tell it. But polka dot shirts and all that, bell bottoms, all that kind of stuff was fashion, was the deal. And, you know, I would notice somebody that kind of stood out. If they wore long skirts all the time and long sleeves all the time and just went from church to school, church to school, I didn't want nothing to do with nothing like that. Whoa. And then once I got into church, yeah, I ruffled some feathers. I might come out on weekday Winston shorts. I thought you was that preacher over there. I see you going around town playing like, oh, yeah, 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 yeah. So, if you're walking, if you're living by any other way, I'm trying to say, by faith and calmness and authority in the Word of God, you're going to get tripped up. And someone's going to lead you down the wrong path because they're going to put you into some kind of law. Some sort of stuff. That's the lesson. I'm out of here.